meet up. That is about how to go from MVP to a scale business. We're very happy to have you here today. My name is Elba Linska, and I will be the moderator. And so we'll go ahead and first we'll do some introductions, and then we'll go ahead and answer some questions. And also, hopefully you have some questions to ask the panel, so that you know we can take this opportunity to also interact with our panel. So I'll start going in order like this. So first we have Pascal Lian. And Pascal, she's a principal at Storm Ventures, focusing on early stage enterprises. And but she's also the founder of a corporate accelerator called Orange Fab in San Francisco. And before we go to the next introduction, I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about how you got you know, your career to this point in time.
Yes. Hey guys. Hi. So I'm kind of an atypical VC, I guess, because I started my career in a corporation. I don't know if you know Orange Telco, pretty massive. And so I worked for Bamford Innovation Division for a long time, over 10 years. And I had a chance to start a corporate accelerator here that was then adopted by the entire group in Europe. And so I got a chance to run startups, and we were writing commercial loans, 20K, and then got a good deal flow, and then started working with Storm Ventures a little after that. And so I've been with Storm for a year, and I went from writing 20K convertible note documents to writing checks between 2 and 6 million to lead Series A. So massive scaling in the check size and a lot of learning along the way. Happy to share anything I've learned.
Thank you. Next we have Hikari Senju. He's head of growth at Yup. And I actually have a couple of things, but I think it will be better if they come from you.
Sweet. So I am an entrepreneur. I started my first company, my second company out of a dorm room at Harvard. So I was a study computer science at Harvard. Senior year, I started a company connecting American college graduates with Chinese ESL company. There's a lot of demand for American college graduates to teach English in China. Not that surprising, but that was that arbitrage marketplace that I created. I sold that company to Yelp.com, where I became the head of growth and marketing, and brought the company to several million dollars in annual recurring revenue, and I manage, in that position, I manage a multi-million dollar marketing budget, so I can speak both to the experience of starting a company, you know, bootstrapping a company, and then also scaling scaling a company to the next level with a sizable marketing budget. So I can speak to that, those two stages. So if you have any questions, I also look forward to engaging with you guys for the next.
Thank you. The next person we have is Cesar Donofrio. Cesar is the CEO at Making Sense, and together with his brother, he founded Making Sense in 2006. And Cesar, can you tell us a little bit more about Making Sense?
Yeah, sure. Hi, everyone. Making Sense is a software company. We build software for successful startups and also for Fortune 500. So in special, we have an incubator when we build ideas, and when an idea gets some traction, we spin that in a new entity, a new corporation. So we did two of those. It becomes a company. One is Doppler. It's an email marketing and marketing automation. It's very popular in Latin America. The second one, the name is Lander. It's a landing page platform. We built that one in 2012, and we sold that one in 2015 to a company here in San Mateo. So I can speak with regards to this topic here from the sourcing side and also from the mistakes that usually you make when I have a technical background. So when you see everything maybe from the technical side and not from the business point of view, so I can share with you a lot of mistakes that we did, and hopefully you can make those. So.
Thank you, Cesar. And last but not least, we have Tristan Cromer. If you looked at the panelists, actually we were going to have another person, but we're very lucky and fortunate that we have Tristan instead. Thank you coach and advisor to startups and corporations from zero to scale. And then I was also hoping, Tristan, you can share with us a little bit about your journey.
My journey is probably a little bit overly convoluted, so maybe I'll do a quick version. I spent 10 years in the music industry as a musician, promoter, producer, and marketer. I moved to IT security for about 5 years, where I operated in 5 different countries, including out of China and Vietnam. And the past 7 or 8 years, I've been highly focused on first moving to Silicon Valley as an entrepreneur, and then figuring out how to scale peer-to-peer systems in education. So I'm really interested in how to transmit knowledge from one person to another at accelerated rates. So I work a lot with governments in terms of how to increase the ability of their country to produce successful startups and scale them outside of smaller environments.
Thank you. So to start the questions and conversation, the first thing that we would like to do, and this is for everybody, if you can all, and we can start, you know, from left to right, if you can all share a story about one of the most successful growth examples that you know, please.
Yeah, so I can talk about one of our portfolio companies called Mobile Iron. So we're doing a mobile device management. And so they started focusing on helping, it was before iPhone, so it was a long time ago, but they're basically focusing on helping IT manager solving the problem of having to run personal and professional email for employees bringing their smartphone at home and asking for that. And so they decided to create a client and started with Nokia and Microsoft. And they had a decent growth, but then it was not like exponential. And little by little, customer call after customer call, prospect after prospect, they realized the highest demand was for this new thing called the iPhone that was really driving the IT managers crazy. And so they decided to kind of impact the product and to kind of like take that AGSM hotspot and embrace it, and that quickly changed the trajectory of the company, of the growth, and that's how they kind of exploded and went from what we call survival to thrival. And that's when the growth became insane, and they raised more money, increased their sales, but they began to form kind of their what we call the go-to-market fit, and were able to take the company IPO and so on.
So, this, I mean, the story that I know best is going to be my story. I can, you know, tell you stories of later, maybe and whatnot, but I'm sure you guys can also find those on my articles online. So, scaling, growing QuickHub, my this the education company, the connected American college graduates with China. It's very hard to develop a two-sided marketplace, right? So, how to get the tutors? How to get the people who want to be tutors in China? What we did is we like scraped college university directories. And then we would send individualized emails to personalized emails to every student. We must have sent like 5 million emails. And it was pretty aggressive, but that's kind of how we initially got, tens of thousands of elite university students who are looking to be tutors, who are looking to make money. Oftentimes, there aren't that many opportunities to make money on the side. Maybe you can be a barista, maybe you can be an Uber driver. So you can make more money, you know, waking up early in the morning and teaching, logging on and teaching somebody English. So that was like the pitch, and that's kind of how we bootstrapped and developed this marketplace. And then regarding the other side of the marketplace, which is the Chinese business side, I'm not Chinese, I'm Japanese, but I have zero connections in China. But I literally just got a one-way ticket to Beijing, and just hustled, met the founder of VIP Kid, which is the largest ESL company in China, at a bar, pitched her that had this platform with tens of thousands of elite university students, got that first deal done, and then kind of networked my way down the list. And so it was two different kinds of scaling, one on the consumer side and the other one on the enterprise business side, but they require a different set of skills. But that's kind of how I personally grew the QuickHub marketplace.
For me also it would be kind of our story. what we did in one of the reasons of the why we built the first product that is a marketing automation tool. So in 2008, we had one of our customers. It was they have a chain, a restaurant. So we, as a professional services, we built a custom solution to do custom emails with automation. So based on that experience, we say, well, we can build something that we can use with other clients. So we built a platform that it will be only on the backend to prepare and to send those emails. So when we were done, we sell to another another customer also on the professional service side, but we went in and we say, well, let us build something else so we can also, people can log in and buy by itself. So we did that, but again, we were a group of more like technical people, so we didn't understand the marketing and the sales side of, you know, software as a service thing. So it took us like 4 years to go from those two clients to 200. So in the second product that we built in the landing page platform, we did that in 2012. It was the general availability. And in 1 year, we went from zero to 200 clients. So I think that the kind of the conclusion for the story is, you know, it would be better when you are building something that you get that expertise. You don't try to go and get it from yourself and learn down the road. So go and try to get or hire someone that it will help us to grow, you know, in a nice way.
Successful story or a failure story?
We're starting with successful.
Successful, okay. Failures are so much more interesting. Okay.
Well, you know, it's fine. Actually, the next question is about mistakes. Okay. But let's do this, though. Let's talk about a failure, you know?
Well, I'll tell you about simultaneous then.
Sure.
So when I was in IT security, so I was a business unit manager of full disk encryption products. Full disk encryption is done by software basis effect time. So it means your CPU is running a lot of clock cycles, desperately trying to encrypt things and decrypt things on the fly, which makes your CPU very, very slow. We had a new product that we were doing in partnership with Seagate Technologies, very, very big partner. We're a relatively small company. We're trying to scale up. We've got maybe a total at that time of like 80 people. And Seagate and us decide to do this hardware-based disk encryption, and they have a mighty four-year plan that we have agreed to in order to secure this partnership. And they want all the features of the software-based full disk encryption system replicated onto hardware-based disk encryption. What I learned from this process is that the four-year business plan was a terrible idea. In fact, it was so terrible that we recognized very early on that there was absolutely zero consumer demand for this product. And if we continued down the path of trying to please our partner, okay, who was basically 500-pound gorilla trying to bully us into it, if we built all those features, we would probably crush our own business. So what we did is we said, yes, we're building that. And then we kind of went over there and said, no, let's start removing features. And what I actually learned from that process is that sometimes in order to scale, what you have to do is not build more, but actually start looking about what you can take away, what you can simplify to get to a broader market that perhaps does not have that early adopter niche expectation of a million features and customizations. But actually what we need to do is pull back and reevaluate the market almost from scratch and re-challenge all those assumptions and throw the four-year business plan out of the way. And from that, we were actually able to recover from our mistake and successfully sell that part of our business a couple of years later.
So just let's stay with you. And so this is an example of a mistake, but can you tell us about some other common mistakes that, you know, that can also be very hard
for scaling?
For scaling, yes.
I find the most common mistake for scaling is forgetting that you actually have to scale the team in addition to the product and marketing channels and everything like that. It is very tempting to, once you get to the point where you have some semblance of product market fit and people are desperately trying to pull the product out of your hands, that the temptation grab people as fast as possible who can actually just have a pair of hands that can then go and do the engineering and do the work. And I do find that that is sometimes very, very dangerous. It's very hard to double the size of your company without losing a tremendous amount of quality. So putting a substantial effort into hiring the right people, making sure that you and your co-founders really are aligned in what's important to the company, the goals and the vision of the company, what you want to succeed in, how you're going to act as a company and as executives can be absolutely critical if you're going to translate that method and that focus and that discipline to your 101st employee, to your 201st employee, to your 1,000th employee.
Thank you. I mean, I think this is a question that we want to hear from everybody, please. So we'll go backwards now. So Cesar, if you can also share some common mistakes that...
Well, one of the... kind of, it was a good, but also a bad thing. So when we build our first product, we have the developer that did that first product. It was not the senior developer that we have inside our organization. Usually we're the developer that we have what we call on the bench, so they don't have an assignment, so they start building our first product. I say good thing, a bad thing is because when we reach those 200 or 500 clients 2 years later or 3 years later, I don't remember, we realize that we have what we was impossible. It takes like, I don't know, the more clients that we have, the slower that the product, it was impossible to change. So we took the big decision to build everything from scratch like 3 years later. So it took us like 2 years to build a new system, a new platform from scratch, and we spent a lot amount of money trying to rebuild everything. So if I need to do it again, what I will try to do is like build like more modules or build like a platform that it will be able to, yes, to have spaghetti code, but on a controlled way, so you don't need to rewrite the whole thing. So I think that is something that we learned. You know, I think it was a good thing and also a bad thing, because if we didn't reach, those 200, if we don't get market fit, it would be, okay, but, it's also better to prepare also for scale.
So the mistake that I'm going to talk about is at a is once you raise a sizable funding round and you have millions to spend on marketing, what happens is suddenly the scrappy startup acts very conservatively as if they've like won or they've like achieved dominance or something. What happens here is either they don't, this is something that I think that's what they've been talking more about as well, but either they don't spend the money, or when they do, when these companies do start spending the money, they freak out if something's not working, if it's not scaling. They continue the scrappiness of constant iterating and testing new channels, right? And this is more money than most young founders have ever managed, have ever seen, maybe even have ever had, and so they just get very possessive of this money, and they can't aggressively test ideas, aggressively test channels, aggressively even test maybe some core product features with this money. They kind of just stick to one thing and then they don't see it working and they kind of freak out and they kind of hope that things will change, but it does not change. You have to continue to maintain the scrappy mentality even once you've raised a couple million dollars. That you have not made it at that point. You're still a startup. You're still supposed to keep growing. You're still supposed to find and discover new opportunities. And I think people switch to this conservative mode a little too soon. And that is, I think, a big pitfall that young entrepreneurs tend to have when they raise that first or second round.
Yes, so as a working for a VC firm, we get to see a lot of pitches and we follow the work a lot of startups. So I got at a couple trends. And I don't know how many of you are in the B2B space? Everybody else is in B2C? No? Okay. Well, sorry, I'm going to talk about the B2B space, but basically what happened is company
So usually when you do B2B and the CFO, the CEO or the co-founders do all the sales. I don't know if you can relate to the B2B space, but and then so they're able to kind of like sell to 10, feel like, oh my god, I made it, I got it. So with 10 to 15 customers, you can raise a Series A. So they're gonna raise like 3 to 10 million. And then they're just gonna go and run and hire a very expensive VP of sales and not understand why there's no growth. And usually that comes from the fact that you as a CEO or a co-founder, the way you sell is very different from the way your team will sell. And so you know the product inside out, you know the market, you have empathy for the market. Most of the time you come from that market, you felt the pain and decided to start a company. So for you to sell is very easy. But for a team of SDR and AE and sales rep, it's going to be much harder. So you need to build what we call the sales playbook. So you need to be able to articulate how to sell. Is it high touch, low touch, marketing intensive? Do you need face-to-face meetings? How many? Do you need a POC? And if you're able to really clearly articulate that sales process, that happens when you're able to see repeatability, which might take a little bit of time and talking to a lot of people. But once you're able to articulate from phase one to phase five, when it's the close, and then able to script every phase of that sales playbook, you're in a great shape. And that's when you can start hiring a VP of sales that will scale your sales and marketing effort. But we like to talk about the people journey. So at first, you need to hire David Crockett, who's going to find its path through the wood, willing to roll up his sleeve and sit in every customer call and listen, right, to be able to build that sales playbook. Then you'll need somebody to kind of rally the troop behind that path and that sales process, sales playbook, and that's going to be a brave heart, right? Follow me, freedom, I found the path. And then you're going to need, when you start really scaling, when you made it, you fought your group and you found your momentum, then you're going to need an eyes and knower, right? He's never led any battle, but he's in the back of the room and he's kind of the strategist who's going to help you scale through geography and niche by niche in your approach to your sales process. So that's kind of like what we see is like people right away hire an eyes and knower, who is not going to write the sales playbook, he's going to strategize, and that's not what you need when you're still close to 1 million in AR. You need a Braveheart RA. I don't know if that makes sense, but yeah. That's one of the trends we see.
Thank you. Can you give a microphone to Hikari? Hikari, you were the first person to talk a little bit about this money and getting the funding. So the next question is, do you think that startups, should they prioritize profits or growth?
Right, yeah. I would just add one last, very quickly add to Pascal's thing and then answer your question. I think companies, what happens is that you hire somebody too senior too soon. And that is definitely a mistake. And that's kind of like the distilled root here. You should always focus on growth over profits. Right, that's the purpose of a startup is to grow. In fact, even Facebook, right, is the market valuation of Facebook is like 50 times earnings because it is at a growth stage, right? Amazon has not focused on profits yet, and Amazon is going to be a $1 trillion company. So, as a tech company, the reason why tech companies trade at multiples of their earnings is because of that growth factor. And so once you're not confused that you're some kind of if you want to be a tech company with tech multiples, then you have to be a growth company. And so that's kind of like the great answer to your question.
Thank you. Can you, because also Pascal, just go back just for one brief moment, because you both of you talked about the funding and the money. So what is your thoughts about prioritizing profits or growth?
So if you raise money, profit is great, but it's not what the VC care about. The VC wants you to get to 100 million in AR, they want you to be a category leader, they want you to return a massive amount of money. So if you're just gonna sit on the money that we gave you to build a little bit of a profit, we're not interested. What we're interested in is the efficiency, your sales efficiency. How many dollars do you devote to sales and marketing? And how many dollars does that return in growth? And if you can stay close to one, so the ratio is one, then we're happy. If it's less than
one, it means your efficiency is not that great. At first, it's fine. We're building a team, it's normal. So it's okay. But and as soon as you go higher than one, it means that you're generating too much profit. You need to invest more to grow faster. So we definitely want you to grow before making a profit. We want a profit, don't get me wrong, but not right away. We want you to grow as quickly as possible. The reason why we want to give you money is so you can beat the competition once you found your momentum, especially at the Series A. So this money, we want you to use it to build a moat between you and the competitors. And that's kind of like why we invest in you, because you're going to make it super big afterwards.
Thank you so much. So staying a little bit on the same things, and now the next question is for Tristan. And the question is, how to build for growth while staying on budget?
How to build for growth while staying on budget? That's an interesting
question.
Because,
you know, we're talking about how growth is very important.
I do think the answer to this question, like, there is a growing tech answer to this question, and then there is also a kind of bootstrapper answer to this question. How many people here are bootstrapping? Okay. Never go over budget. Please don't do that. You will be bankrupt. If you have capital and you can raise capital, or even if you have a profitable model, like Pascal was saying, I mean, if you are bootstrapping and you can spend $1 to earn $2 and then reinvest that money, awesome. If you have an equation like that, you can just go to the bank and take out a loan and use that to scale. But you do have to be cognizant of the reality of the situation, and I think it is a very poor idea if you are bootstrapping, you are not planning on becoming a billion-dollar company. I like those companies. Many of my friends are at those companies. It's okay to be earning a good living and make a $10 million company or a $1 million company. Yes. Please stay within budget by being lean, being scrappy. Don't be inefficient. Don't buy a MacBook Pro with AirTab for everybody if they don't need it. You don't need 5 monitors. You don't need to pay full market value for your Apple monitor. Go buy a Dell for $50 used. Stay scrappy, stay lean, and stay focused on the real stuff, the real metrics that are going to drive your business, like activation and retention.
That makes sense. Anyone wants to add anything else
to
this question?
Yeah, actually, So we like to invest at what we call product market fit, right? And I think in the life of a company, before you find product market fit, that you raise the seed or not, you need to be scrappy. You need what we call that the survival mode. You're trying not to die until you're able to prove that you found your group, that you have a model, that you have paying customers, and it's repeatable. Before that, just stay on budget.
Ramen survival.
Ramen, like basement of your mom's house or something. But that's where it's tricky. Once you found that product market fit, you've raised money, and you found that like go-to-market fit, and you're able to like reach that roof, then everything changes. You've been used to this crappy and everything, and then now you need to go quick, because you found a good spot, you found a good model. Everybody's gonna see it. You're gonna stop making noise. And everybody's gonna follow that model. So if you don't grow as quickly as possible, they're going to catch up with you. So that's when you need to go from like survival to thrival. So your mindset is crazy. You've been used to just eat ramen all day long and not spend any money. And all of a sudden you have to be in every press article. You need to be as visible as possible to be top of mind for all your buyers. So the mindset has to change, and we call that like phase of unlearning. Because whatever saved you in the survival phase might kill you in the growth phase if you decide to raise money or if you have massive profit and you can reinvest. So I thought it was like kind of a fascinating thing I found out when I joined Stone Ventures. You're going to unlearn.
Thank you. Yeah, we can pass the microphone to Cesar. I think I have a good question for you, Cesar, that kind of, it's, the next progression. So we're talking about funding and money, but what we really want to ask you is, what are your thoughts on how to build a scalable team?
I think that the first team that you will put together, between 1 to 10 people, maybe it would be your friends, it would be your brother, like in my case. So I think that that first team, for sure, it can take you from 0 to 1 million. From 0 to 5 million, but when you would like to go from 5 million to 50 million, I think that maybe it's a different team. Not everyone as part of that first team, it will grow at the same level. So you need to keep an eye on, you know, who is performing, who is catching up with the level that you are moving the company. So, and sometimes you need to take, you know, difficult decisions as part of the founding member of the company. So I think that that is important. If you are able to scale, you need to keep track of who is part of your team and who will be running at the same level that, you know, the company will require. So I think that that would be my advice.
Thank you. Anyone else wants to add something about the how to scale a team? Your thoughts?
I'm going to just add a quick comment.
Yes.
Like that, again, just like be a little bit cautious when you are scaling your team, that whatever problems you have now or whatever biases you have in your team are going to magnify as you grow. So if you are one of those lucky people that you get to scale your team really gradually, and you look around your room of like scrappy five people, and they look just like you, and they think just like you, now might be the time to start hiring and focusing on diversity, both gender, race, religion, thought, background. That is extremely valuable. Those are the people who are going to challenge your thinking. And I know it's really uncomfortable, but that's really critical before you start scaling, because whatever biases you have now are just going to be absolutely magnified as you scale larger. So please be aware.
Yeah, and also as part of that team, it's important the culture of the company. What do you want to be the culture? You know, there is a different definitions, but I think I define as a mindset of the company. You know, I did work, and I'm working today with a lot of different cultures, you know, from Canada to Argentina and Mexico, developers and project managers. So, you know, I think that it's important that you have that mindset. For example, the 5 minutes in Mexico, they are not the same five minutes here. So you need to make sure that as part of the company, you have that mindset. You know, you have that culture that you can, you as a founder, you know, as a leader of the company, you need to make sure that you keep that culture. Because if you start growing and you don't have that culture, you will end up as a, with a big bucket of you know, bad apples, and it will be difficult to change that. So I think as a part of the company, you need to do that.
And then I have one thing to add regarding team. I think, especially for tech, your team, your people are your assets, right? You're not an oil company, you're not a farm. You don't think of your team members as some kind of cog. Right? I think there's this idea that people are replaceable, or that you can just spot and replace this head of sales or head of engineering or engineer. No, the reason why you give equity to your employees is because they're the asset, right? Tech, people are the asset. So nurture your people, invest in your people, give your people the environment and the space they can to create their best work. Especially as the company grows, the future of the company is decided by the millions of micro decisions that the people in your team are making on a daily basis. It's not whatever you top down decide. It's the bug that the engineer is not getting fixed, or a small strategic marketing decision that one of your marketers have made. Those are the things that's going to kill or break, you know, make or break your company. And in order to make sure that they do the right, that they make the right decision, you have to invest in your people. So in tech especially, your people are your assets. If you're not a tech company, then maybe your people are not the assets. Maybe you people are expendable. Maybe you just need someone to work that farm. But in tech, the people are the assets, and I think it's very important to value and focus that and make sure that's a priority in investing in your own people.
Yeah, I'd love to do another movie analogy. We've taken the CEO in mind, back to the point where you have to unlearn and evolve and grow the company, or that could make or break the company. So when you start as a CEO, you're on every front, you're a warrior, so you're Captain America. You're in every call, in every sales call, you're the CFO, you're everything, and you have a team, but really you're the driver. And as you grow, you need to start delegating. And to do that, you need to find a team of superheroes that will save you on every front, and that's the Avengers. right? And you need to find your CFO superhero, your marketing superhero, your product superhero. And you need to let these people make decisions for you. You can't make all the decisions anymore. You can't be in all the sales call anymore. You need to trust these people, back to the equity point. You need to give a share of the company to these people. And your ego has to evolve with that as well. You might not be always right, right? And then as the company scale and you found your growth, you unlock the growth, then you have to become an academy, right? And you become Professor Xavier, and you build a system, and you're able to really build an entire organization that will scale with your product. And that's when I create a lot of tension within people who used to be the Avengers or were next to us with Captain America, being upset to now it's like 1,000 people or 100 people. And so what's hard, and we talked about that a little bit, is if people don't change, you have to change the people. And that's also the strength of the CEO, is to make the changes needed to be able to help the company in its upward trajectory.
Thank you. Before I ask the next question, I'm wondering, so we've been talking about scalability and funding and teams and culture. Is there any questions that this conversation has sparked in anyone so far? Yes?
More question. I was wondering if you have any insights from in terms of scaling on a product, about your product at a product level. It sounds like you talk a lot about your staff and the company, but what about the product level? Scaling that product itself.
Who wants to start?
So I think that first of all you need to find your market fit. So you have like two type of products that you can build, maybe as a B2B or B2C. One is build something that maybe there is a competitor or you are sharing some of the features. So I think or build something like brand new, you know, like something like an innovation. Something completely like new from scratch. So you need to find whatever is the market fit. For example, for a B2B product, you need to make sure that you get people that will pay for your product. So first of all, you need to find that market fit. And usually to do that, at least my experience is like bootstrapping, you know, to be able to raise your first round of money. So it will be, you know, testing, you know, the features and make sure that MVP is something that people is able to pay for that feature, for that product. So there's a great book, it's Lean Startup by Eric Ries. So I think that is a great book, you know, that it will teach you how to build, you know, a product that will have the right feature that people will pay for that. So.
One thing to add regarding the product versus team, there's a saying that, you know, if you want either like a great product or great idea or a great team, you know, you always want the great team, because the great team with a bad idea will always just throw out the bad idea or the bad product or the bad feature and come up with a better product or a better feature, right? A bad team, though, with a great product is not going to be able to execute on that product. So that's why team is I think, why we're focusing so much on team, is because it does come first. The great team does then create that great product. And in terms of, you know, how do you iterate the product, you know, listen to your customers. I mean, it's pretty obvious stuff. Like, listen to your customers, you know, look at the data, and they're telling you what they want. And so build what they want. Build towards the demand, and then trust the judgment of the people that you've chosen to work with as well.
Maybe I can add one quick just metric to look for, maybe. sorry, maybe I'll use the microphone if my voice starts dying. You might want to consider, as if you do get that inflection point and you have product market fit, but look at your iteration velocity. Is I think one common theme that you're hearing now. If you start seeing that your team is no longer able to go from idea to getting it into the hands of a customer, like it's now taking 1 week, now it takes 2 weeks, now it takes 3 weeks, you're going to have a fundamental problem very, very quickly. So keep an eye on your the cycle time of your learning, essentially.
Yeah. Well, the some maybe we'll be talking about this later, but you also need to make sure one of the mistakes that we did with our second product, it was, we get a lot of, users that they will pay for the service, but the problem is that the attrition of the product, it was really high. So we have a great, ARR, but the clients or the user, the paid users, it will stay using the product for 3 to 6 months. So you need to make sure that you have those metrics also as part of the your dashboard, and you need to make sure that you can follow that. And whatever is the reason why your users are not using your product for longer period, you need to really change the features and make it more attractive. So.
I know there was another question, but just very quickly, anything else that you guys want to say about the metrics, since we are on that topic, about what are some important metrics to track as we're scaling?
One last thing to add is, also there's a human fallacy to believe in small numbers, right? If something is not statistically significant, that's not really a result. So just because you have 10 results of something can be a complete fluke, right? People want to believe that 10 results is enough to make a decision. But at that point, you're really still just using your gut instinct. Generally, statistical significance is you need about 300 samples of data, so a minimum to be at an 80% certainty. And so just keep that in mind as well, because there is a human bias towards small sample size and making decisions with small sample sizes. And I think that's an important thing to be wary of as well when looking at metrics.
I don't know if you guys are interested, I can tell you what we look for when we're looking for product market fit. But it's 10 to 20 paying customers for
B2B.
This.
B2B.
Huh? B2B, sorry. Yeah. B2C is an entire different game. So B2B. So 10 to 20 paying customers, same use case, very important too. So we can start seeing that repeatable sales cycle, sales process. And then for us, one of the good proxies, 1 million, getting close to 1 million in ARR, annual recurring revenue, with like a growth of 20%, 10 to 20% month over month. And that's for us a signal that the company is found for a market fit, ready to get Series A, ready to scale and ramp up the sales rep and the sales team.
Thank you.
Yes.
The question's about what you guys mentioned about investing in growth once you get funding. So hypothetical situation, let's say we raise $750,000 and we want to invest in growth. What are some type of investments to avoid, like, based on your experience or what you've seen that it's just a mistake? But maybe people commonly think it's common to do. Get an office, don't get an office, don't work in a garage.
Are you B2B or B2C?
B2C. Oh, and to add to that, our strategy is to, in terms of investing in growth, to make investments with resources or anything else that has direct contribution towards hitting those KPIs.
Yeah, which is just for us, if the product, so if your product is ready and you're focusing on growth, it means Series A. And in B2B world, Series A is going to be 2-3 million to 10, 15 million. Numbers have changed, and like that used to be the size of a B or C. So for us, it's 150 would be like almost a seed, which for us would mean you're still working on the product. But since I'm a B2C expert,
So regarding how to allocate, a seed fund to prove a product market fit, because that's what you're still at, you're trying to prove product market fit. One obvious solution is obviously paid advertising, right? Because it creates, the way I view paid advertising from like Facebook or Google is not necessarily because that is the best channel per se, but it is because it creates a story, right? You can say, I put in $5 on Facebook and I made $10 in revenue. That's a story that you can then pitch to investors, right? You can't, if you spend say $100 million on some kind of growth hack, right, where you do something using one-off thing that is not scalable, and that's great. Maybe you got 1 million users from doing this growth hack, but that is not a story that you can pitch investors, right? And so that's why paid acquisition is, should be a strategy in a when you've raised a seed round, Because you're trying to create that narrative, that you're trying to paint this picture for the investor that if they put in $5 million, that they can then get $10 million, right? And if you can show that with a little bit of marketing dollars you're spending, you know, 750K, and you can get, you know, at least break even, right? Then that starts to create a story. But then at the same time, a lot of companies have grown without any paid advertising, right? Duolingo, they grew completely based on PR, right? And they're massive, they're the largest education company, right? So you don't have to go through that paid advertising route, but paid advertising, I feel, you do so you can tell a story to investors of to paint a picture of how you scale that growth.
Well, that's good feedback. Well, what are some like mistakes that you guys have seen that people have made in terms of investing their dollars towards?
I think one thing is like hiring an agency and then just blowing a lot of money right away. That's pretty bad. I think, again, this kind of gets to getting to the point of hiring too early, too soon. Somebody who's not maybe, you know, a VP of marketing at a very late stage company is not trying to prove product market fit. They're just trying to deploy capital for brand purposes. It's a very different kind of purpose of marketing than the kind of marketing you're trying to do with a smaller budget, right? At a smaller budget, you're doing more performance direct response marketing to paint a story of how you can scale growth. You're not looking to spend money doing just general brand awareness things. But a lot of big ad agencies, their MO is brand marketing, right? And but you can't track brand marketing. You can't say, oh, you know, we got this TV ad and now people are kind of more aware of our brand. That's not really a story. So I think one big mistake is like focusing on brand marketing a little too soon. And trusting somebody senior that they know how to spend your marketing dollars, just because they're senior or because they're big agency, they're good at a certain stage, but they're not necessarily good at an earlier stage.
Okay, can I add one quick thing to say?
I agree too. I've owned two digital marketing
agencies. Just trying to invest in a platform which allows you to iterate faster, like. Change to your product and you're not investing in a A/B testing system, that is a crazy waste of money. So invest in things that will allow you to test even faster, and that again includes the team.
Right, from customer feedback. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
By the way, there will be an opportunity at the end to approach the panel and ask more questions. I want to ask one more question to all of the panels, and then we'll see if there's any last questions from the audience. But one thing we would like to make sure we ask asking all of you is any last thoughts or best practices that you would like to share with us? And who would like to start?
Well, I mean, one thing I think we haven't really mentioned is culture. I think that's very important, especially as you're scaling and growing. Culture does not matter when you're 3 people or 8 people, because the culture is whatever conversation you have with your co-founders. Culture does start to matter, though, when you're at 30, 50, 100 employees, hundreds of thousands of employees. Because at that point, what makes or breaks the company, again, is the small decisions that the rest of your team makes. It's not what you and your co-founders, your 3 co-founders, or you and your partner decide, right? And that's where culture becomes important, because culture is then critical to make sure that people are rowing in the same direction. Culture is like, you know, the coxswain that's shouting row, right? And it's making sure that everybody is, when everybody has these small decisions, again, whether, you know, how to spend their marketing budget, for example, or whether to fix the bug, or whether to invest time in fixing a bug that people might not, you know, that might not even matter. That's when culture matters, right? Because that's when that becomes the guiding post to decide what they should invest on an individual basis. And so as a team scales and grows, the importance of culture, it becomes more critical. And you've obviously seen companies that have very bad culture, and they scale and they completely implode, and they destroy a lot of shareholder value, because the direction that the company is aiming at, and therefore the direction that all the people think that, you know, that what matters is wrong, and then you're heading towards a very bad direction, right? So that's why, as you scale, it's important to culture becomes more and more and more important. And therefore, you have to sanitize your culture to make sure that people are rowing in the right direction and making decisions in the right direction. Yeah.
So who wants to share next? Last thoughts and best practices?
Sure. I think maybe since we've talked a lot about data and data gets so valuable when you're trying to scale, maybe I'll say the exact opposite for no apparent reason. It's important to look at a lot of the data, the quantitative data in this case, but please recognize that any single test that you run is not going to have Six Sigma significance. You're not going to get 99.999999% certainty. You do need to run a lot of generative testing, a lot of qualitative testing to understand what to run your quantitative tests on. You need to kind of take one perspective from doing some customer interviews, and another perspective from observing your customers directly using your product, and then run another perspective by getting running an A/B test to see if anybody clicks on that button, and actually try and triangulate on what the user actually wants. So continuing to run those tests, continuing to get quantitative and qualitative data at small scale is going to be critically important, especially when you're thinking about scaling to other regions where all of those assumptions that you think you've already proven are going to come back to bite you in the ass because the new region has completely different demands and the next customer segment has completely different demands. So don't forget that basic stuff and just talk to your customers and watch what they're doing.
For me, I think that it's important to that you have a really passion for whatever you're doing. So, and the same thing for your team also. Make sure that things it will get complicated down the road, very complicated. And you need to make sure that you and your team have passion for that thing. We saw so many companies that they will start in one direction and they move, and they will find a way. So let's make sure that you and the founding team, they have that passion, and you know, then after that, try to be the best in your area, and that it will make it. So sounds really easy, but it really take time. At least for myself, it took me a lot of time to find that passion. You know, I move from different things, but at the end of the day, you know, that is what the what it will drive. You know, what I am happy when I wake up every day very early because I really would like to work on what I'm doing today. So I think follow your passion.
I can talk about a quick anecdote. Going back to the company I mentioned, being Mobile Iron, when they were still trying to find a product market fit, the CEO's office was kind of in the middle of the office with big windows and still finding product market fit, so still taking a lot of customer call as a CEO. And he had this big whiteboard where after each call, he would basically write down two things, the pushback and what he called the wow. And with each call, you would kind of like see what was the pushback, what was the customer kind of saying that would just go against buying the product. And then he would also document everything that he felt like the customer got on the edge and got really interested. And to go back to the culture, so the CEO is rolling up his sleeves, and as the team walks by, sees kind of that whiteboard through the window with like the pushback and the wow, everybody was like, wow, can I actually document my own findings with my call? And so that whiteboard, that big board became the playbook, the sales playbook, where everybody has studied like collaboratively enter their own data. And then what happens, the product team, to go back to the product discussion, walked by and said, wait, we got all this wow factor around the iPhone clients, and we haven't started developing an iPhone product. Why? We should get at it. So the awareness of the product team of what happened during this customer prospect calls became critical for everybody back to the rowing together in the right direction. It gave so much transparency to the entire team. And again, finding product market fit, you still have one office, one floor, everybody can still kind of talk to each other. But that whiteboard became so critical that it kind of like gave the true north for the company.
Thank you. Does anyone want to ask the last question before we close the panel?
Yeah, so how do you make difficult decisions when it comes to growth in teams? And I think you mentioned working with
people in the back couldn't hear, the question is about how making difficult decisions and pivoting along the way.
Well, I think that you need to do it. You know, if you would like to grow, if you would like to move, just do it. Whatever it would take, you know, how to do it. You know, and again, I think I saw a lot of cases when your team or the group of people, today we are around like 200 and something young people in the company. So some of them, you know, they were okay when we started like 10 years ago. But others, they don't catch up. They don't follow, you know, the growth of the company. So you need to take, you know, tough decisions, and you know, you have to do it. And if not, I will close the company and we'll start a new one. I don't care. You know, just have to do it.
Are there any red flags you guys look out for when going down that path?
Well, so this question, I feel, almost ties to Pascal's first point, right, which is about like the different stages of the company. And when you're starting off, you have to be fearless, right, because you're the kid, you're the teenager, you're growing, right? As you grow, as you mature and you become an adult and you know, have more and more shareholders and investors and stakeholders, then you become mature, then you hire the senior exec, but the purpose of a startup, the purpose of a company is to be fearless. You're being paid to be fearless, right? Like, that's your job. If they want a stable return or somebody, you know, they put in an index fund, right? So it's not natural, right? It's scary. Like, it's not natural to take risks or be constantly out of your comfort zone, but that's what you've signed up for. That's what a startup is. That's why investors are putting money in you. Because they want you to be fearless. They want you to take risks, maybe even break the law, right? You can't do those things when you grow up, when you're large. Right, but what's required for you to achieve dominance is a very different skill set than what is required to maintain dominance. Right, and oftentimes companies struggle once they achieve dominance of then switching gears to becoming maintaining dominance. But everyone in this room is still at the stage of trying to achieve dominance, which means you're supposed to break rules, you're supposed to be fearless, you're supposed to make mistakes, you're supposed to have regrets. Like, be fearless. Worry about those other concerns when you get there, because that's not, you know, the purpose at this stage is to do whatever it takes to get there, right? Once you're there, then you need to worry about switching gears, becoming mature and being an adult. But as a teen, but you're a teenager, you're supposed to break rules, you're supposed to make mistakes, and you'll be forgiven for it largely. You'll be forgiven for it. You will not be forgiven for it once you're very large. But you're going to be forgiven with red at this stage. In fact, people almost admire and accolade people who are the rule breakers, right? So especially at this stage. So I would not be too concerned of making mistakes. In fact, make mistakes. Like, go out there, be out of your comfort zone, because that's what the investors are putting money in you for.
I'm never forgiving the scooter companies. I will punch whoever is putting all those scooters down.
Why?
Oh, I trip on them. Great for some people. I have one red flag which might be helpful on a pragmatic basis, and that's my red flag is called Janice Frazier. I have a few others like David Bland or Emily Chu. It's just, I can't see my own blind spots, like, by definition. So having other people who are willing to be brutally honest with me and challenge my assumptions is extremely valuable, because you probably don't know your own red flag.
Yeah, ego is the biggest enemy. If you can put your ego on the side, listen to the data, or listen to these close collaborators you've selected at first, that's good. It could really help you, the entire company. So to see ego as like the biggest enemy at first.
Thank you so much. Before we close, Pascal, if you can tell us a little bit about this event coming up, and we'll pass this around.
Yeah, so actually all the stories I've been telling, they come from a book that one of our partners wrote with the CEO of Mobile Iron. I kept talking about Mobile Iron. And so think about it, like an investor and a CEO write a book about their journey like 10 years later, right? So you have a book with the perspective of an entrepreneur and the perspective of an investor. And the book is about the journey of a B2B enterprise leader. So I talked about survival,
not dying, and then there's like a point where you click, and we call that the go-to-market fit that makes the difference between not dying and thriving. So basically, it's all in a book, tons of anecdotes, tons of examples, and so we're doing an event on May 3rd to kind of like talk about it. We have a bunch of speakers that will address what is that blocking point for B2B companies who try to go from product market fit to massive growth. And then again, we call that the go-to-market fit. So the book articulates very well what is the go-to-market fit, and it has to do with finding your go-to-market model, finding your go-to-market playbook that will script what happens at every stage of the playbook, and then finding that urgency, finding that wave that will carry your company to the next level. That was the advertising minute.
Thank you so much. And let me see. So what I now need, I need a volunteer. This is going to be something quickly. So volunteer, anybody? It's going to be something very easy. Okay. So can you give me two numbers from 1 to 40?
13 and 7.
13 and 7. So those lucky people are going to get a book. Woo!
Yes, well, thank you so much for being part of this panel with us.